Oh, Fun HH. I opened KQ little O EP to 900 off 18K. Talkative Rec, who 3 little B folded to me before dinner calls. HU flop QQ A tiny little R check check. Turning 9H bringing FD I check. Planning to CR because he thinks I'm FOS, he checks. River 9, I toss out a 5K chip into an under 3K pot. He tank calls Mux and says, nice catch. Then, next hand I river straight with capital T and get paid. He's not even in the hand and says, nice catch again.
Rolling on floor emoji. Tell him rivers are like Pokemon. To win, you gotta catch them all.
I'm definitely using that one.
Good luck, friends, swappers, and horses. They got me. I really am the worst.
Why are you doing this to yourself?
KK into AA. 20 straddle BB limps UTG 100. We call KK, button calls. BB 450, UTG 2600. We call 2600, button all in for less. BB jams for 5800.
I mean, it's just a cooler, man.
I knew it was AA only though, man. FTGB.
No one knows what that means.
Fuck that guy, bro.
Face palm.
Welcome to the S4Y Vlogcast. Of course, those hopes are high. And of course, I am joined by Matt Berkey, my gracious co-host, and the Dominican flag, my gracious country. And I'm going to bring to you a bunch of topics today, everything from buying action, from summers of the past. How are you feeling?
I'm good, man. I'm pumped. I woke up today feeling a little dangerous, you know?
I woke up today happy that we found funding for this podcast.
Hey, shook out the couch cushions. We got enough change to hire a crew.
There's
AKA
a crew.
Conrad.
There's a person under this table right now.
He's our fluffer.
Oh, my Jesus. All right. Well, the summer is upon us, finally.
Yep.
And you decided to add more projects onto our plate besides playing a bunch of tournaments every day.
It's what we do, you know? 65 days of MTTs. 7 to 10 vlogcasts, if you will. So a new term we made up.
What does that even mean?
So, you know, vlogs are a thing. Mm-hmm. Podcasts are a thing.
Yeah.
We've been wanting to do both. Feel like it's a good time to just smash the two together and see what kind of baby can be born.
What is this supposed to even look like? So this is a vlog. This is a podcast inside of a vlog.
Yeah, I think so. I think like the idea will be that we're still going to do the summer vlog the way we have in the past. Mm-hmm. You know, we're going to effectively take something similar to last year's results may vary. Mm-hmm. We're going to smash that together with previous year's S4Y Chronicles, where we're just kind of like heading around the Rio, following each other as we make deep runs. And then, you know, you and I have been wanting to start a podcast for a long time. So
yeah,
figure we might as well turn the cameras on and see what we can talk about.
I like it. I've been back and forth on this idea of a vlogcast, but I think I'm a little bit onto it. So last year was crazy in terms of like having camera crews follow us around. We always had to text, I'm on red 81. And then if you were next to the rail, then you got preferred treatment and the
right
cameras came to see you, you know? So are you expecting to do that again this year, or what kind of plan do we have in terms of?
So obviously Pigtails, our gracious production crew, has been doing this for better part of 3 years now. They just can't keep giving up their summer to be here. We just have way too much other stuff going on. They're taking care of the sub site while we're playing, as well as getting ready to launch this documentary to be determined. So we're training, man. We are a team in training. We got our boy Conrad, our boy Corey. They've been looking to do some more creative stuff. Yeah. So they're working on the editing side. Conrad has credentials. So, you know, if somebody makes a deep run, we're going to get that footage and we're going to make a package out of it.
Did it bother? Does it like take something away from you? Like when you're vlogging. So for me specifically, it's like I don't. Like it's a little bit of a sacrifice, right? It's like you don't get to have a break. You don't get to just like, you know, when it's a break, you have to go meet the camera crew, get a little snippet in there and things like that. So it's a little bit more taxing than just like a normal summer. At least for me, I don't know.
So
I know you've been like big time famous for a while.
No. Like that stuff doesn't bother me at all. But what I am very, I guess, unconfident in or what does take me out of my comfort zone is having to walk around with a camera myself, which you and I are going to be doing a lot of this summer.
Yeah.
So like, I don't know how much you've done of this. I mean, I know like when you do it, it's really good, but generally it's like some scenario where like we're at the office and I hand you a camera and I say, film something because you haven't been on the vlog for 2 months.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is going to be different.
You know, not every episode can be like straight fire. Maybe it can. Maybe I'm like Scandal.
We only got to put 6 or 7 out this summer, man.
Nah, but I know you. It's going to continue.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, for sure. It's
like, oh, no, this was great. Let's just, you know, another series.
No. I would like to see this be a permanent thing. I think it marries the best of both worlds, and I think like it's something that we can be good at. Do you have any anxiety, like just walking around the Rio with 2,000 of your peers while you're filming yourself?
Like I see Jeff Gross do it every day. So to
Jeff
me,
Jeff Gross is hype.
Yeah, it's just like he's just like, hey, what's up? And then if someone walks by, they're just he gets them too. And it's like. So I mean,
do you have that in you?
I think I could. Okay. I just don't like talking while everyone's around.
Same.
You know, because it's like that's kind of weird.
Nah, it's true. But like you got to get used to it. Like it was the first summer we did it, 2017. It was really tough. Because, you know, most of it kind of fell on me in a lot of ways. Like, even when Jai made his deep run, I was in another event and I was like passing the camera to you.
Yeah,
and, like,
yeah.
You like filmed your feet. Like, we got a solid like minute and a half of footage of like your feet and Dugan. That's and it was just like, I think there's somebody playing heads up right now, but I'm not entirely certain.
Was that the same summer where? Is that the same summer that you had that photo with Gatsby on the rail?
Yeah.
Was that the Six Max or?
No, I didn't make a final table for the Six Max that year. It was just a, maybe I did. No, 1500 Six Max.
1500 Six Max.
Yeah. You're right. That was the one. And that was probably one of my favorite like overall memories from summers past. Mm-hmm. Just, I mean, it was really cool. Like the vlog that we put out was really good. Like having like that whole section of the Thunderdome kind of to us.
Yeah.
Where like there was like 20 of you guys up there like cheering and I never had a fucking shot in the event.
Nah, like, you were fine.
Honestly, man, looking back, I played that event bad.
Yeah, but
I came in crazy short and got up to 50 bigs.
Yeah, but we don't know what we know now.
Yeah, no, I get it.
So it's a little bit unfair. What are your thoughts in terms of like making this a bigger platform than Results May Vary. Although Results May Vary, probably the best quality vlog out there.
Well, so like my thing is I want to like start to branch, right? Yeah. So like I want to be able to greenlight projects like Results May Vary in the future. Mm-hmm. It's just hard obviously during the summer because we just don't have enough hands yet. But you know, we want to bring back the Heads Up Challenge at some point. I want to be able to maybe if we all go to the Bahamas in November, maybe we do like a sketch type thing down there instead or whatever. Like just in general, when we have downtime, I'd like to be able to turn the production crew loose and say like, get creative. Yeah. And like you can see the intro to this, like it falls into that bucket. They're not gone and forgotten. You know, they're still laying their little touch on what
everything.
What we're doing. So like I want to continue with things like that. I still go back and watch it. Like I think it was just really well done. A good player is going to cash like 25% of the time if the field's super soft.
It's not going bad, but it's not going great.
How many times have you bought into the Colossus?
I only win in 11 times.
I don't fold full houses, I don't fold top two, and when those hands don't win, I'm fucking out.
Do you think that this vlog was a jinx?
Are you wearing clothes under there?
Sort of. I'm heads up for a bracelet right now.
We're going to get so rich from this.
Just got to go to the yellow section or stand outside the ropes.
Okay, I just busted the main event.
Yeah.
But I also want to be able to like start to hit other mediums. So I thought a podcast was really important. I think that like, you know, we can begin to do like shorts, not like comedic shorts or anything like that, but more so just like mixing the world of like entertainment and poker content and, you know, training all into kind of like one vat.
I like my montages in those vlogs.
Yeah, of course you do.
They're just like, they're pretty insightful, you know? And they're always like sparked by something you say. It's just like, oh, you think I'm boring. Oh, okay. Yeah, no, I'm really excited to like, you know what's interesting about the like recording something while it's happening? Because like most of the time, and I think this is what makes vlogs so crazy and good, is that you kind of catch it in the moment. It's not like something that is like, oh, this is what happened to me. It's like, no, this is happening right now.
Yeah.
You know?
So, yeah, yeah. For the viewer, they're kind of watching it in the past tense. But you're right. They get the context of like it was filmed in real time.
Correct.
So like, you're getting real reactions. You're getting things that like really do kind of peel back the curtain and demonstrate what's going on at the series.
50 years of World Series of Poker. I only seen like three.
This is only your third?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, one, two, maybe four. Maybe four, but that's it.
Well, how many times have you played the main?
Three. So this is three.
Okay.
Yeah.
What are your results in the main?
I cashed once.
First time?
Yeah.
And then you missed the last two?
Wrecked.
I sent him a taco emoji that said, want a taco about it? Yeah. He said no.
Like, how am I winning? I can't win. We make a king, he fucking piles, and we look like I'm sitting there like an idiot. Like, just like... Like, how am I winning here? Like, I can't win. He just has to have it.
I think what's great, though, is that I may have just turned a corner where I'm no longer self-loathing and insecure.
May I help you?
Do you want to talk about it?
Oh, that's my line. The best way I can describe the main event as a whole is you found your dream girl, carrying through the romance, experiencing new things with her, and then she breaks up with you. And your whole world comes crashing down. You want to be a strong, sophisticated man and just say, good for her, I wish her well, and I'll show her, I'll just win the little one. You know what? The little one's a six.
She doesn't care about the little
one. She doesn't give a shit about the little one, she's a goddamn 10. The world just tests me day in and day out as to whether or not I have the ability to make ridiculous folds. And we know the answer, I don't. I just don't. I don't fold full houses. I don't fold top two. And when those hands don't win, I'm fucking out. The guy who's second in chips today is like a fucking tobacco farmer in Montana or some shit. Plays poker once a year. There's no justice in this fucking game. I hope the tournament ends right now. I hope they don't crown a main event champion. Something happens, ESPN can't televise it, they pause the tournament for a year. And let us all buy back in.
So what are your expectations this summer compared to the past three?
Well, for me, I think that my hopes are that I have like a pretty big summer. Just simply because I feel really good, way better than I have in the last three summers.
Yeah.
So it's a situation where like, I understand that like a lot of it is out of my control, but like my hopes is that everything in my control, I do well.
Well, so I guess like, I'd like to hear you kind of talk about a little on a couple ends of the spectrum, right? So first, what like does your volume look like now compared to year one?
Mm-hmm.
And then secondly, like what does that 6 to 8 week lifestyle look like?
Yeah. So my first year was, I mean, I'm not going to say it's like, it wasn't important because it was nice to get my feet wet kind of thing. So
were you playing on your own or were you still mostly playing cash at that point?
I was playing mostly cash and then I just like said, these are the highest value events that I can't miss. So I played like, I had 14 events on the schedule, which is like nothing.
First summer you played 14 events?
Yeah.
My first summer I played two.
Yeah, I had 14.
One events. Of them was the main.
Well,
and that was back when they gave you chip for chip.
Yeah, and I still felt like the chips, we didn't get enough chips.
I played a 1500 where I got 1500 in starting chips, at quarter.
Yeah.
And I played the main where you got 10K.
Wow.
And
so things went fast.
I didn't make dinner anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I played 14 events. I had 14 events on the schedule. I think I catched 7 events, which is like.
And you played on your own dime?
No. I mean, I sold. I mean, I played on my own dime.
Yeah. Yeah.
I
you sold. Weren't backed.
Yeah. Yeah. I wasn't backed.
Right.
So that was fun. Pretty much now I was like, oh, I've cashed 7 events. So the next year, I definitely should cash more because I'm playing more. No, I played more and cashed less.
Yeah, of course.
And it's like, oh, man, whatever. I mean, I definitely punted a couple times. And yeah, I mean, every year the volume has increased a little bit. And now I'm like, I'm backed. So I get to play a lot more. My schedule is like pretty massive in terms of.
So what are you investing like dollar amount?
Me?
Well,
or like
the overall plan.
So there's 100K in buy-ins.
Okay.
And
that's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot. That's way more than like the last couple years.
Yeah.
So this is definitely my biggest summer in terms of investment. And it's good, man. Like I'm excited just because like between like myself, my backer, the people buying pieces, it's like that's $100,000. Like that's a lot of money that is being invested in my talent.
Yeah. So what does the lifestyle difference look like between then and now?
Yeah, I mean, 3 years ago, I was definitely not doing what I do now, which is now I'm like, you know, eating well in terms of like, you know, keeping my carbs low. My energy is a lot higher. So the reason I wanted to do that is simply because like I know these days are like 12 hours long and like having like peaks and valleys of energy is just going to be like pretty crippling. And I remember that from like last year or like the year prior. It's just like, man, it's 8 p.m. now. And it's like, I haven't eaten since like 4 or dinner, like, yeah. You know, whatever. And it's like, I need to just have high energy, high focus level, like throughout the day.
Yeah. I think like one of the biggest things that people should be looking at whenever they're trying to have a big summer, be it cash tournaments or both, is just putting a big emphasis on the things that they can control.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that like as poker players, we naturally do the exact opposite.
Yeah.
We put a big emphasis on things that are out of our control and spend a lot of time like rehashing hand histories you know, a lot of other bullshit that you have to go through throughout the summer and just default to the things that are in our control as just like things that will happen. So rather than putting a big emphasis on sleep, food, you know, exercise, things like that, the emphasis actually shifts instead to hours at the table, winning and losing, hands, you know, a lot of this stuff that's like largely out of our control.
Chip stacks,
man, that the Twitter or the tweet of death is always like, I'm chip leading event X.
Yeah.
And then boom, chip stack.
I'm telling you, man, the chip stack, the reason why is like some level of like attachment where it's like, let's say you tweet the chip stack and then all of a sudden you're in a tough spot where like you have to hero call for a lot. But like you're pretty confident that you're right.
Yeah.
But now you just pass because calling and being wrong deteriorates your chip stack.
Yeah, you don't want to fall off peak.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? So. It's just like you've already put out there what your peak is.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want to like somehow be the guy who was like chip leading an hour ago and is out.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, what's your schedule in terms of the series and like what you've been doing of like prep?
Yeah, so I mean like there's been a massive gradual increase for me. The first 7 World Series I played, I was strictly a cash game grinder. So like I would play somewhere between 5 and 12 events.
I still feel like I'm a cash game player though. Like at heart. But like it's different
now.
At
heart.
You know?
I am too at heart. But yeah. It's like where the money is to be made during the summer isn't in the cash games anymore.
Right.
They used to be like super soft, but like the people who come here strictly to grind cash are gonna be really solid and confident and tight.
Sure.
And you know, the game's just like they're good, but they're not
The same.
They're not worth sacrificing whatever your
EV is.
EV, right? It's not about the hourly.
Right.
Because like your hourly is probably still larger playing comparable stakes. But the thing is that the opportunity reward through winning an event is so much greater. Like when you can just like pick up 6 figures in a 3-day span, that just gives you opportunity to then go find some soft cash games that are larger than you would otherwise play.
Yeah.
And I think that's kind of huge. So like 2012... was the first year I put in big volume. I sold a package, and I think I like basically broke even. 2013, I was broke, sold a big package again, ended up making 3 final tables, had a big summer that summer, made like 500,000 total, which I got to keep about half of, and have been playing a big schedule ever since. And you know, the thing is that the big game runs every single day during the summer.
Yeah, I remember that.
And it's good. It's as good as it'll ever be during the year. But because of that, my seats are far less frequent.
Right, right.
And then on top of that, like, I have most or all of my own action now. So I'm just like investing heavily in the series this year. I have like 56 events on the schedule or something like that, that I have 100% of.
Yeah. That's
and then
huge.
I'm like weighing my options with the 50K and the 100K,
right,
which I'll obviously sell to if I decide to play. But yeah, early success will dictate a lot. I'm just trying to rip off this big 50, man.
It's everyone
I'm trying
everyone.
To be the guy.
Do you think that's going to be the biggest tournament ever?
Oh, for sure. They're going to shatter the record.
Yeah.
I think like all four flights sell out for sure.
Yeah, I'm planning on like going down there regging for the Thursday flight. So you spoke a little bit about the like buying and selling action. What do you think the marketplace of buying and selling action is right now? Because like for me personally, it's like I don't even enter the marketplace.
Yeah.
Like I'm pretty much just like send out a couple messages. I'm like, yo.
Yeah, you got a private network.
Right. Like I'm selling. We negotiate the markup and it's just like boom.
Right.
You know? I feel like blessed to have that because it's like I'm there watching, you know, so like whatever my backers, like let's say like the exposure is too high for the series. Mm-hmm. Obviously, like I can't, like my backing agreement won't allow, like I don't want to get into like 100, like I don't want to put all that on the stake.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
So like whatever we sell, and but you know, selling 100K worth of action is not like the easiest thing in the world. Right.
Right.
So I'm just like, wow, I'm like pretty lucky. I could just like hit up my network and hit up my stake and just like put it all on.
Yeah.
But what do you think the state of buying and selling action is right now? Because for me, I'm like, I'm looking at it myself where I'm like, if someone's on the marketplace, that's already like a sign of maybe it's not that good of a buy. But how do you think?
So here's the thing. I think it's not even remotely close to being a seller's market right now. Like, okay. It is a massive seller's market. Mm-hmm. And the reason being is because the average buy-in has gone way down and the amount of volume you can put in has gone way up.
I see.
So those two things correlating has made markups from the floor standpoint rise tremendously, right? And the irony is there's never been more scrutiny to markup than there has been this summer, right?
Right.
We saw the tweets leading up with Deeb
and Vibes.
Freudian slip, man. Freudian slip. Yeah, with the whole Deeb and Vibes thing that was going on, you know, and there was a bunch of other like things that were called into question. But what ended up happening is that the floor tremendously rose. And the reason why the scrutiny is actually coming into play is because people who otherwise would say, it's not worth me to sell because I think my hourly is worth more or I'm personally worth more. I have a higher ROI than the market would ever pay,
yeah.
Right? So usually what you'll see is a big compromise in the ceiling of all this where the best players are just not selling
right.
Because it's just not worth it, right? They're the best, so they have some form of liquidity. And if they don't, they have a strong network who's willing to pay their price.
Right.
What's happening now, though, is we have some very talented players who just can't afford this amount of volume, right? So they're forced to sell. And the other side of that coin is that staking is all but obsolete.
It's gone. It's,
I
feel like it's, so in my view, I feel like it's around, but it's like really hush hush.
Super, super, super quiet because nobody wants to get involved. Nobody wants to take on more horses that they haven't spent years vetting or whatever the case. So like before you just used to pluck from an online player pool.
Right.
And you could tell like through volume, like who was decent, who wasn't. That's kind of gone. And now you have this shroud of mystery where you have to guess based on Hendon mob results and things like that. So staking is really diluted, meaning that more people are hitting the marketplace that otherwise would have been able to find backers in the past.
Correct.
And they're charging exorbitant amounts because they're testing the ceiling, not the floor, right?
Right.
So what you're finding is like, there's a lot of bad buys between like 1.1 and 1.3.
Right.
It's just heavily hyperinflated. But the idea is that like, these are $500 buy-ins, these are 1K buy-ins. Most people
should be winning.
But like that's obviously false due to the nature of MTTs. Most people should be losing. And sure, there's going to be an influx of recs, but recognize that when 35,000 people play the Big 50, like, you know, maybe 60 or 70% of that field is just pros who are entering 2 to 6 times.
Right, right, for sure.
So you're kind of seeing like, you know, 2/3 of the field actually just being represented multiple times over.
It,
And not that Lucha ROI, man.
For sure.
Like, if you're selling 1.4 in the Big 50, but you're firing off five bullets, then you better be worth like 2, 2.5, 3, somewhere in that neighborhood.
So how do you go about buying?
I just don't.
Yeah.
I buy from close friends that I truly have faith in.
Right.
And it's one of those things where it's like, I'm sure there are a lot of really good buys. Like, I actually bought a piece of Sasha because she's playing mostly PLO.
Right.
And I just have no exposure there.
And we also understand, like, she's probably okay.
You know? I think she works. And I want exposure to what I think to be soft game types that I otherwise don't have. And I thought she was selling at a reasonable price.
Yeah, for sure.
But, like, you know, that's kind of a one-off.
Right.
Like, just in a general sense, outside of the main, I don't really want to buy. And, you know, you and I have been a part of kind of like running main stables.
Main stables.
Or like.
And, like, it's tough to even find good buys, man, because the people.
Everybody's overpriced.
Everybody's overpriced, or like.
We saw that regress a little bit over the last couple of years, though, right? Mm-hmm. Because it was recognized. People were recognizing that the final tables of the main was getting a lot tougher.
Yeah.
So you were finding that good sweet spot at like 1.2, 1.3. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, this happened now where the floor has increased on prelims. So in coordination with that, the prelims were getting a lot tougher.
Correct.
There were a lot of 2Ks, 3Ks, 5Ks. Well, the Venetian just wrecked
that. Yeah.
They just said, look, we'll run a 400 every day and put a million guarantee on it.
And they're going to crush it.
Yeah, we're just going to crush.
Yeah.
And that now brought the floor back up because the World Series had to compete. So I promise you, like, main event pieces this summer are going to be out of this world. You're going to be looking at like 2.0 for like winning regs.
Winning regs, yeah. Yeah, it's an interesting market, man. I actually have never seen a cash game summer here, like ever. I've never played cash here
in the
summer.
Yeah, yeah.
Just sporadically, you know, like I'll bust the tournament. It's early. I walk and I see like 10:25 running in King's Room with like D-Moon or whatever. And I'm just like, oh, I'll jump in, you know.
Tell the truth. Tell the truth. When you play cash during the summer, it's because you tilted.
Nah.
Yeah.
Nah.
You're literally over tournaments the second you decide to sit down for cash.
Definitely over tournaments. But I've always said, like, all right, I'm going to let, like, a couple hours pass. I never, like, snap, like.
I'm not implying that when you play cash, you're in a mindset where you can't win. I think you're a big favorite.
Yeah.
I'm saying when you deviate the cash.
Oh, yeah.
Which is off the plan.
Yeah, because I'm like, fuck this. Because I want some control again.
Yeah. You know? Like, instead of just going and laying by the pool and getting your dick tan like everybody else should be during the summer, you're like, I don't need these next 6 hours. I just have to make $1,000 to make myself feel better.
That's funny. Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be an interesting summer, man. I'm really excited about it. I'm not sure who's going to make a final table first, but it's going to be I'm waiting to see.
How many final tables do you think we can make?
Me, you, and Hunt?
Yeah.
Seven.
Seven?
Yeah.
That's a big line.
I think we make seven.
That's a big line.
I would take action on seven.
How many did we make last year?
I don't know.
I think Hunt made two.
Hunt made two. Hunt made four.
Hunt made four?
Mm-hmm.
We didn't make any.
So that seven is reasonable.
Is it?
What do you mean? He made four. What are the chances he makes four again? Low. So we should get good action on seven.
I think you're doing this all wrong, man. I think we could have got four, and now you blew us out of the water.
Nah, better action. Four is tough, too. Like, it's hard to make No Limit Hold'em final tables. It's not like we're playing Mix. It's not like we're playing PLO.
Right.
You know, No Limit Hold'em final tables is, you know, all these fucking killers,
huge
man.
Huge fields. It's not even about the competition. They're massive fields.
Yeah, the massive fields, massive land. How do you traverse these fields?
Patiently. I mean, I feel like prepping for the MTT Academy, like, over the last few months was just an exercise in getting myself ready for the World Series.
It is, though. It helps a lot.
Yeah, no, I mean, I feel like when you're really laying out the curriculum day in and day out and you're painfully going through what you're supposed to transpose onto people who are less experienced than you, who it may be their first series, or, you know, they're East Coast grinders who are, like, starting to take shots at bigger buy-ins, or they're finally getting buy-ins that they're comfortable with, you know, the 500 to 1K range. You have a certain onus on you to just, like, say, okay, like, here are the nuanced points to look for that you can kind of really leverage. And the thing is that the structure's changed a lot.
Yeah.
So now we're operating big blind, Andy. We're operating with much deeper stacks to begin with. And, like, that's gonna alter the state of WSOP MTTs a little bit. I loved the structure before. where like by dinner you knew a quarter of the field or more was going to be gone.
Now it's going to be long.
Yeah, it's like you make dinner breaks day one, and it's like it's tough not to cash.
Yeah, you're almost there because you were usually cashing early day two.
Either last level day one or right. like first level day two. Yeah, right.
But now, I think we're probably going to be looking at dinner day two. Yeah. It's going to be weird.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, you just understand that like you're extending a certain phase of the event, and that just requires you to readjust your incentives. And
do you think that brings down your ROI overall, just because
you'll be playing
less events?
Well, yeah. I mean, obviously, like you're going to end up playing longer in events where you don't cash,
right?
Or where you cash for
minimal, yeah.
Right? But I think the payoff to that is first place is going to be larger in all events. It's a give and take. It's like, yeah, you're going to be wasting more hours where you make no money, but when you have that big score, it might be worth like 25% more. It might be worth 30% more. That's a pretty big uptick.
I think it also brings in the cash game players that are like, oh, I can't play these short stacks. Now all of a sudden they have a little bit more maneuverability. They might fire it.
Man, I hope you're right, because that means that in 2019, cash game players are still stupid. And I am a cash game player. Like, I love it, and I would never... You know, I definitely have that certain arrogance about me where, like, tournaments aren't poker.
Yeah.
And cash games are really, like, where deep stack, let's go. But it's like, if you play enough of both, you recognize that they're separate strategies. And if you're bitching about, like, the early stages not being deep enough or the middle stages not being deep, like, you're just wasting your time even being in the event.
So I've never played cash during the summer, obviously, besides, like, the sporadic. But, like, for players that do come here and say, like, I'm playing cash,
yeah,
you know? Like, what do you even look for? Like, cause I know I play my main game is like 5-10 at the Wynn.
Right? Yeah.
So sometimes I'm there, and obviously we'll talk in terms of like normal games, and then we'll talk in terms of like, you know, the hush hush games.
Yeah.
Whatever. So like I'm there, and I'm in a game with Harrison, and he's like, oh yeah, you know, we're here every day at the Wynn, every single day. Like, you know, you don't even have to go anywhere else, whatever. So like, obviously that's the cash game side, you know? Mm-hmm. So how does a cash game player go about finding good games? How do they go about, like, how should their schedule look like? I've never done it, so.
It's hard, man. It's harder now than it's ever been.
Yeah.
Because your hourly is so much more scrutinized now than it was, like, in 2012, right? So, like, the last time I really grinded cash hard during the summer was 2011. I was playing Bellagio 10-20-40 every day. And it was tough because, like, you knew that you had to sacrifice a big chunk of your time to this, right? So I would wake up, I'd hit my routine, I'd be out the door by 11. Same as like the tournament grinders, right? And you hope to catch the morning crew so that you can get into a game relatively soon.
Yeah.
But like if you miss it and you show up at like 1:30 or 2 after people start busting the events, it's over, man. You're on a 50-person wait list.
That's crazy.
And like there's nothing you can do. You can't just say like, oh, okay, I'll leave and come back.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like, because it's just perfect. 50 for the rest of the night.
Yeah.
There are no tables. There's nothing they can do to accommodate. So, like, you just have to understand that, like, a big part of being a cash game player is you have to play bigger because your hourly is being cut by the amount of time that you're on wait list.
That's crazy.
And the smaller you play, the longer the list.
It is, yeah.
1-2-2-5. Honestly, they should just, and I hate to say this because I know that, like, it's kind of unfair. But honestly, it would do the entire poker ecosystem a favor if they just didn't run 1-2 anywhere in the city during the
summer.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense, though.
Right?
Because this, the 2-5 list is like 50 deep,
yeah.
100 deep.
Yeah. The thing is that the vast majority of the players in the 1-2 games are losing players to the ecosystem anyway. So it's good to kind of spread them out in a multitude of ways, right? Put them in 2-5 games where they have a shot at variance being favorable to them, and they don't necessarily go broke as quickly. They're paying less rake, so they're not losing to the rake as fast,
right,
which is very, very critical to the reason why a lot of people in 1-2 are losing players, right?
Correct.
It's the rake they're not beating in a lot of instances.
Right, for sure.
So now, you know, forces them to make a hard decision of like, do I have enough to take the next step up? And if so, some of them are gonna get rewarded tremendously.
Yeah.
You know, if not, then it's like, well, should I maybe start grinding the 115s?
Yeah.
The 115s at the Nugget or, you know.
Something.
Yeah, these smaller buy-in events that have big rewards. And again, like, you know, it's I don't think you're going to see, like, a massive exodus of low-stake players, right?
For sure.
I don't think you would see a rapid rate of them going broke. I don't think you would see like them just not showing up now for the summer.
I think at least in the major casinos where the bigger games right. run, like Wynn, yeah. Aria, Bellagio, they should just wipe out those games during the summer. And then have the other casinos like Venetian and, you know, where the 1-2
Even
games...
Venetian, like they're running their tournaments out of their poker.
Right, right.
They can't even run cash.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But like, yeah, when you're talking about like Treasure Island or right. or the Golden Nugget or whatever, Orleans, like let them handle the small stakes stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying this as
like a big time, like, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not trying to big time small stakes players. I'm actually trying to, you know, kind of imply that like it would be doing them a huge favor. Mm-hmm. The vast majority of them just can't beat a $5 to $6 rake in a game where the max buy-in is $200.
Yeah, $200 to $300.
It's just, you know, it's really inconceivable. And, you know, the casinos don't necessarily want to do that because those tables are just rake churners.
Right.
But the reality is they're not making that much money off of them. And they would be making a lot bigger money players happier throughout the course just by freeing up those tables. It also frees them up to run satellites if they're hosting their own events. It also frees them up to now, you know, pass those players throughout the entire ecosystem. And, you know, this is the problem where I think most rooms cut off their nose to spite their face. They say poker's a losing endeavor. We don't care like what the ultimate long run goal of it is, yada, 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 right? But the fact of the matter is, it's like if they're making the same amount of money at 1-2 and 2-5, the rake is the same, right? So it doesn't really matter. If one of those keeps your poker room open longer, spread it more.
Right.
You know what I mean? Don't cater to a lower level. And I'm not saying that 1-2 should be abolished. It shouldn't. The rake should just be alleviated.
Yeah.
But I understand with operating costs, that's hard to do. So it's just like at times like this where there's an influx of tens of thousands of people, you know, we should be a little bit cognizant of what will keep the bottom of the ecosystem most healthy.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Have you ever thought about just being like an advisor to like rooms and stuff?
I just don't think that I have the value they're looking for. Like, I think I would be able to provide value to the players, but I don't really think that rooms covet that very much.
That makes sense.
What I mean? Like, to them, it's just all about their bottom line. And I get it. They're a business, right? That should be all that matters. Poker initiated as a loss leader. It was like, let's get people in the door so that they can lose in the pits. And it turned into a very skilled, competitive profession.
Yeah.
So now it's kind of like an auxiliary extension of a lot of casinos.
How about the other games now?
The hush-hush ones?
Yeah. How about the other games? I've been trying my best, man. I've been trying to get in there, you know, like a little rat. Like, just like I want to get in here, man. All right, the game's about to start. I'm going to sit here, you know? But obviously you've been inside. I've like kind of on the outside looking in, like just trying to knock on the door for like the bottom of those games. What's there? Because obviously that's tough.
It's super hard, man. I mean, you know, look, at the end of the day, just like the bottom of the ecosystem needs to be protected, the same holds true for the top. What I can't get behind is the poaching.
Right.
I think that it's just like one of the most egregious things in the world. The fake lists, things like that. Like, I totally am on board with keeping things on the up and up. And I'm totally like, I have empathy for everybody who's kind of like on the outside looking in.
Right.
You know, I had been in that situation myself prior to getting into the Ivy Room game. A while back, there was just this special player who ultimately ended up moving to LA. He was a big part of like the Garrett, Aussie Matt scene. And, you know, I was just shut out of every single game. I was the first one on the list every day, and it was just like the game was going to start and break nine-handed. So that sucks. It's frustrating. But also just recognize that, like, as much as it's the host looking out for number one and them trying to take care of themselves, it's also just, like, that small pool of available players who can, like, invest money in that arena,
right,
protecting, like, their ecosystem as well. And... yeah, I mean, you know, it's hard, man. It's a hard juggling act. Because, like, what do you do? What do you do when the biggest game running is 10-20-40 or a private game that's 10x
the stakes?
And the
10-20-40 game's just tougher than likely the you know, the 200-400 or the 100-200 game.
Yeah.
It's like,
well, I think what you'll see this summer, and I have a lot of respect for the guys who do this, and I think that it's a necessity. It's a necessity to fight the private realm, is be a game starter.
Right.
I think the guys who are willing to sit down two or three handed and just fire up 100, 200, knowing that it's the World Series and people are going to stumble by and they're going to play.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And those games are going to fill. I think it's a big way to kind of like carve into that private sector, because the fact of the matter is, like, I don't think the quote unquote soft money cares who they're doing business with. I think they just
That's
want
true.
I think they just want
business.
Yeah, they just want a good, legit game where they're pandered to a little bit.
Definitely.
And they feel like they have a fighting shot.
Yeah, definitely. Like I've, you know, playing 5-10 at the Wynn, like I've come across like a lot of these like VIPs that are they play in the other games. It's just not running right now, but they want to play poker, so they'll sit in the 5-10 game. And you know, they just want they want action. Like they don't want people to sit there and just like, you know, not give them any action, just play good cards, you know? And they don't mean like they don't want you to play trash. They just won't want you to like never talk, never play hands, never call from the big blind. Like, you know, only show up with the nuts and like be like kind of like a bad person for the game.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
But at the same time, like what I realize is it's not that they don't want to be in a tough game. They don't care about the money. What they want is you to be almost like a good person and talk to them and like exchange thoughts and be a smart person.
And also just recognize that they're giving action. Yeah, they don't want you to just like cannibalize them.
Correct.
Right? They want to feel like they have a sporting chance.
For sure.
Like they want you to return the favor and give a little something up to get their action.
For sure. That's kind of what happened. I was playing 5-10 at the Wynn and it was me, the Australian kid, Adrian, and this other like a VIP. And, you know, I would like raise to like 30 and the guy would be like, I don't have that good of a hand. And he just goes 500. And it folds around to me. He's like, all right, just call. We'll check it down.
Yeah.
And I have ace queen.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, all right, whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Like call. And then he wins in like with like a jack or something, like jack eight suited.
Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, nice hand. And I give him a pound and like we move on. And then he's like, yo, let's do $100 PLO flip on the half. And then everyone, it's just, everyone's like, nah, I don't want to do that. And it's like, bro, like, so it just ends up being just me, him, and Adrian.
You know what you do in those situations?
What?
Just keep gradually upping the stakes until those guys leave.
Yeah, that's the
just
move.
Make it 5, 10, 20. And then, like, as soon as somebody, like, starts to say, like, they're not going to be in for the mandatory straddle, just be like, floor, we'd like to change the game permanently.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And, like, what they'll do is you can't change it permanently without everybody agreeing, obviously.
Right.
But the whale will just threaten to leave.
Yeah, he's like,
the VIP will just be like, I'm going to leave if you don't let us change this to 5, 10, 20.
For sure.
And then that person is going to be under a ton of scrutiny where, like, if he breaks the game, then you just go start the game somewhere else.
Honestly, it's so true. I don't get it, though, because the thing I don't understand, it's like, bro, the $100 PLO flip has no...
It's neutral EV.
It's neutral EV. Like, why are you not doing it?
Yeah,
either you're under-rolled. You're under-rolled.
100% they're under-rolled.
Exactly.
It's like they want something for nothing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, this is the biggest problem that, like, people don't understand. Like, you know, I get a lot of grief where it's like... Oh, you don't play according to the rule book, man. Like, you know, you do these things and they're so outlandish and they're so bad. It's like, you don't understand. Like, you don't know what it was like in 2004 coming up where, like, it was free money as long as you did your due diligence to not be a thorn in people's sides.
Yeah.
Give people a reason to quit and they will. Give them a reason to stick around and have a good time with you and they'll never leave your side.
Yeah.
Right? It's the idea of, like, shearing a sheep versus skinning one. And it's like... That's like the gambler's maxim. And everybody's gotten away from that because poker has turned into this methodical, thoughtful, deep, you know, nuanced game where like everybody's a professional now. It's like, okay, that's great. And I respect that to the fullest. And I'm also putting myself into that camp.
Right.
But just recognize we're always going to be in an environment where it's human versus human.
Correct.
Right. And if we're not, we're going to lose. And the game's just going to distill down to nothing anyway. So as long as that's the case, you better be welcoming to the people who are gracious enough to put food in your mouth.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, I don't act like it's not an act. It's like, I understand why this person is sitting here. And I also understand why a professional is sitting here.
Yeah.
So you just treat them differently.
Yeah. And
you're just like a human being too, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's super interesting. Yeah. I mean, I don't know what else to add.
I'm pumped, man. I'm ready for the summer. This was supposed to just be a preview vlog, but...
this was a preview vlog?
It was supposed to be, but, like, it's just never going to be that way. Like, once we start rolling, we're just going to talk.
You should have told me it was a preview vlog.
I mean, it's
or
whatever.
Or a podcast, or vlogcast.
Vlogcast. Yeah, it's a vlogcast.
Do you like my flag?
Yeah, man.
You ever been to DR?
No.
I'm going to take you to DR.
Mm.
You like women? All right, well, I hope you all enjoyed this preview, also/official, also/released. It is a wrap for the Solve4Y vlogcast, and we'll see you next week, hopefully with some hardware. If not, hopefully with a big check. Good night and good luck.